Hello, Daddy. Hello, Poo Poo Poo. Hello, Poo. Hello, Poo Poo Light. Yay!
You're listening to the Renaissance Men podcast. Listen and subscribe on Patreon.com. Now here's your host, Stuart Garrard.
Good evening and welcome to episode 73 of the Renaissance Men podcast. I am your host, as always, Stuart Garrard. Joining me this week are my brothers, DRB, Seddon and Mideon.
Oh God, that was too much excitement already. For someone that's been isolated for a week and a half or however long it is now, I'm still not allowed out, even though we're in lockdown.
Quite right.
We're in lockdown too, anyway, which everyone says to me, oh, we're in lockdown too, so it doesn't matter. I'm like, well, yeah, it does. Obviously, you've not been self-isolating. I cannot leave the house at all. So when the weekend comes Sunday, I'm actually allowed to go out and do normal things like see my son and leave the house. I dread to think what the car is going to say to me when I try and start it up on Sunday morning, mate, because it's not been, it doesn't like sitting there.
It's like you're on day release.
I know, yeah, that's really, what I feel, you know, right? I feel like a pedo that's allowed out.
Why change your habit of a lifetime? You're also a little wiser, aren't you, now?
Birthday.
You've ticked over the old birthday clock.
Yeah, I'm the grand old age.
How was it in lockdown?
39 now, yeah. I've got some cards, obviously. People can still post things to me. I'm not going to... do anything that way, yeah. People drop stuff at my door, got cards through and all that kind of stuff. But like we were saying the other week about the presents and all that, I bought like everything I want, and people literally just gave me money for the things that I'd already bought that I wanted anyway. So
yeah. Well, that's like me and my PS5. That's pretty much how I saved it all up, like just like early birthday presents, to be honest. But I guess we should ask if that you are feeling all right. I mean, no, you didn't.
No, I didn't have any symptoms or anything like that. Just got told by the overlord of the app and the text messages and emails to not go out. I mean, it's pretty ridiculous. I think the whole time, I'm nearly finished now, but they sent me like two text messages. Oh, just to check that you're still isolating, you've got to still do it, you know.
And all stay alive. Inside, you pedo. Do we need to count you anymore, or did you die?
I got my food shopping last week from Iceland. It was all right.
Nice.
Didn't come till like 10 o'clock at night, so I was starving by the time we got here. But I bought enough food for at least a month, let alone a week and a half, so I'm okay.
Well, many happy returns, Mideon. Thanks for joining us. And, you know, your lockdown will soon end. Society, take notes. He's being released. DRB, how are you, sir?
Oh, yeah, it's not too bad. Yeah, happy birthday, mate, by the way. I don't think I said it on the group text.
It's okay, I'm 39, mate. I don't remember if you said it or didn't anymore. So
I know, it doesn't really matter. I think it's my... Actually, no, it's Stu's next, isn't it?
It is, yeah. End of the month, and then DRB shortly thereafter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have the end of the year birthday gang. A cool gang. Seddon, you're not invited, so sorry.
Thanks.
But yeah, DRB, how are you keeping... In this, the first day of the UK lockdown, is it UK wide now? Are Scotland in lockdown? I can't remember.
They're in some kind of lockdown, aren't they? Lockdown too, yeah, not too bad. I can't really complain, to be honest, because down here in the southwest, we've got it fairly easier than most. So, yeah, not feeling too bad about that. But other than, you know, we can't go and socialise and do stuff. But I'll survive.
Good. Yeah. Again? Lovely to have you here. We're going to talk some Trump with you later, so
good.
Brace yourself, audience. Seddon, how are you? The man who likes to isolate anyway. How are you doing?
It's nice.
Marvellous, I would imagine.
I actually had 2 days at home as well, not generally because of lockdown, but I managed to not have to go to, well, I say not have to work, but to work from home. So it's lovely. I've actually... started lockdown doing the thing I like the most, as you say, being at home, away from other human beings. But yeah, not bad so far. managed to see a argument in a shop since lockdown started about masks. And you just think, Jesus Christ, you're still arguing about masks. You know, you're not even supposed to probably be in here, I say, as I was doing my essential cigarette shopping. And, managed to see like what was almost kind of a street party down the end of my road last night where, I don't know, whether people were just like protesting. And I just thought, knobs, and just closed my door.
How bizarre.
Yeah.
How very strange. Yeah, it does. I don't know if you guys feel the same, but it does have an air of just, I don't know, like lockdown lights.
Yeah.
You know, people just don't really seem to care. The kind of shops that are open still, like WH Smith's, I'm not quite sure WH Smith's are an essential service.
I was asked that question. You want your, from Andrea. Yeah, she said, is it an essential and can you pick some stuff up for me next week? And I went, well, regardless of whether it's considered one or not, it's not bloody essential and no, I can't.
I know B&Q are open. How they qualify, I have no idea.
Yeah, yeah. So garden centres, they qualify.
But Dunelm.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like a half measure, and you can't have any serious impact unless it's like me, unless everyone's literally isolated. But like, even though shops aren't open, they're just doing the old click and collect. So to do click and collect, I don't know if the government realises, but you need to leave your house to go and collect what it is. So I don't know how click and collect's okay. You might as well just open the shop, man.
Yeah, yeah. I guess we can all just relate. Thank God, like Game and Amazon are still running for our PS5 pre-orders.
It was weird. I went past the Game at about 7:30 in the morning the other day, and it was open. And I thought, shit, they're taking like this really extreme, haven't they? They're going, well, let's open for many, many more hours than we used to be.
Yeah, everyone had to pay the other day before lockdown in full for their console in the shop, so I could go and click and collect it. And I saw a lot of sad tales on Twitter, like, well, I only get paid at this time. I plan to have the money on the day it came out and all this kind of stuff. I can't afford it now and all this kind of stuff. So
that's got to sting. Yeah.
I've also seen many, many stories on Twitter of because of lockdown, people crying that they should release it earlier.
Fucking idiots.
Yeah, I don't think they understand the logistics quite of how these things get planned out and work. It's like a billion-pound company. They don't just, at the drop of a hat, say, okay, we'll release them all now. It's planned for months in advance, and it's not really affected anyway. They already came out and released a statement and said there's going to be no sales in the shops anyway. They probably had non-manufactured sell in the shop anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, just be patient, people, you know? Fuck's sake.
It's not long now.
That is stupid. I mean, even when I put out an album years ago, it took about 6 weeks of processing to go through before it could be released. How the hell are you going to do it on the console? Okay, we'll just drop it.
There was a lot of kind of going, well, clearly they've got them all in a warehouse somewhere. Surely it's easy. Yeah, that's how it works. Fucking idiots.
Yeah, but people still have to deliver it from the warehouse. It's not... You're not going to soon drop every other delivery that you've got planned just so someone can get a PS5 the same day as the rest of the world.
Yeah. Idiots, eh? We've got a lot of interesting chat this week. We're going to talk some Trump, some US elections, and the boys. We're going to be looking at kind of reviewing Series 1 and Series 2 of that. And the PS5 embargoes have lifted, so we're going to talk about the early thoughts on that. And, the Xbox, because they also... To be fair, they also lifted as well. And of course, we'll talk about what we've been playing and watching this week. After this break, we're going to answer some listener questions in our Ask Us Anything segment. And of course, I'll ask my brothers, what have you been playing and watching? So join us after this.
Gracefully fisting a tunnel through the anus of audio. This is
the Renaissance Men Podcast.
I done spent my last 3 cents mailing my letter to the president. Didn't make a show, I didn't make a dent, so I'm swinging over to this independent chain. Stetson Kennedy, writing his name in. Stetson Kennedy, writing his name in. Can't win out to save my soul, long as Mathers DuPont's got me in the hole. And war profit boys are squawking and barking, that's what's got me out here walking and talking. Knocking on doors and windows, up a rundown election morning and scribble in Stetson Kennedy.
Welcome back, and it's time for our Ask Us Anything segment, where listeners to the show come onto our Facebook page and they ask us, well, anything, quite frankly. And this week, I've got a philosophical motherfucker for you this week. Okay, listener, Kate Cav asks, do you believe in God? Quite simply.
Is there an option B? Like, is it, do you believe in God or would you rather eat seven sausages?
It's not.
That's what I'm used to.
No.
Damn it.
It's not an either or. You know, it's not, yeah, it's not that. It is simply, do you believe in God?
Well, way to keep it light, Kate. Well, I identify as agnostic, so technically that would be a no, but I'm not completely adverse to the concept.
Oh, dear. No, yeah. Yeah. I don't know.
That was quite interesting, because I've got no idea what you three think.
No.
I could have had a punt. What I reckon you guys are, but yeah, I have no actual idea of what your beliefs are. Funnily enough, it's nothing we've ever really covered on Twitter chats when we're generally doing knob gags and paedophile and AIDS jokes, is it?
Not really, no. But I guess it's an interesting one. I mean, I'm not sure is my honest answer. I think I would just give the stock answer that no, but I feel there's something out there. Whether that's, I don't know.
Well, that's sort of an agnostic as well.
Yeah, a gaseous cloud. I'm not sure, but yeah, I find it hard to believe that there is some dude with a beard up on a cloud kind of dictating all of our fates just by a click of his fingers. If it's Morgan Freeman, like in Bruce Almighty, something like that, then yeah, happy days, but no. Mids, are you a believer?
I think we already know. I think we already know that it's a no from me. And not even like there could be anything. There's nothing, man. That's the way I look at it anyway. There's nothing. I like gods like Zeus and all that kind of stuff. But
got a war.
The actual god that I think the question's referring to, then no, I don't think exists.
Sin, I know what your answer's going to be, but please enlighten us.
I'm strong in the mid camp. I am 100% no. I can't sign up for it as a concept. And I don't know. I'm fascinated by it though. I would say it's one of the things that fascinates me the most. And I have a little bit of jealousy for anyone who can believe in a god, because I think it shows an ability to do something that I can't. I need some sort of evidence or something to kind of hang my hat on to kind of believe in anything like that, and it's just devoid of that. And yeah, I do think it's quite amazing that people can make that the leap of faith, but I just can't buy into it. And again, much like Mid, I love mythology, and I love the idea of the gods of old and things like that, but any modern gods, if you can refer to them as modern gods, none of the religions, I just don't buy it. And especially the fact that there's so many religions. I don't know how you could have so many competing gods and people still think that their god's the right god. Leaves me massively cold, man.
What we need is a god-based Royal Rumble, really, don't we?
Yeah, I'll be down for that.
30 gods in a ring. One winner comes out. It would have to be like 1992 Rumble, wouldn't it? So you actually make crown a champion at the end of it.
Oh, Vincent, yes. To come out though and win it, wouldn't he? He'd beat his old partner, God.
He'd, he would, actually. Oh, God, I've forgotten that angle.
He'd book himself over God, easy.
I'd forgotten that. Oh, my days. Christ, when God was an actual character in WWE for a period. Jesus.
If I was a better man, which I clearly am, I would have gone no for Mid. A no-ish for DRB, but with a curiosity. And Stu, I was really unsure on you. I didn't know. Nothing we'd ever talked about. I don't know.
I love the concept of faith. You know, I kind of make it. I think there's a bit of a distinction between having having faith in something to kind of guide your life, and then believing in someone that can do miracles. They don't feel one and the same to me. That's kind of how I feel about it in my head. But I think it's like a coping mechanism for a lot of people, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think that, you know, what is the alternative? The alternative is you just die and that is it. Obviously, your corpse becomes rotting and decayed. You become worm food.
And that is one of the things that fascinates me, is kind of that concept of going, like, why? Well, it sounds terrible. Sounds like I'm going to do something bad. Like, why do I bother going on if I think that this is really fine, mate?
Jesus.
Why am I doing the stuff that I do? And why don't I go out there and just do whatever I want, whenever I want, to whoever I want? But you're right. You kind of, whether it be a religion that holds you in check, but you build some sort of moral code for yourself, don't you? I mean, like, I did go to like Sunday school and church and stuff when I was a kid because my mum and dad believed. But as soon as I was given like any choice, I was like, no, I'll stay at home and watch cartoons. And I guess that's where I built my moral compass from, was the heroes from the comic books and the cartoons. And
Tom and Jerry.
Yeah, yeah. But I don't know. I do think it's a fascinating subject. And it's a shame because I don't believe. I think whenever I talk to someone who does believe, I've got so many questions to them that it sounds like I'm just having a go. And I'm not. I'm just massively curious. And because I think there's a lack of logic in some of it, when you ask questions based on logic, people do sometimes take a bit of offence, as if you're just sort of saying, well, you're dumb for believing in that. But I'm like, no, I need to kind of get into your head and understand. Well, I mean, like, it's an age of one, but like, understand how you can think that there weren't dinosaurs despite all of the compelling evidence that there were dinosaurs. And if you now acknowledge that there are, how can you believe in an infallible religion that's based off stuff that said there wasn't for so long and things like that? I just find it great. We need to get someone on here to educate me on religion on this podcast.
That'd be hilarious. Fucking hell.
And by the sound of it, it's not a you three.
Not really, no. I mean, I do lean more towards atheist than Christian, obviously, but only because there's no proof that there's nothing. I have to identify agnostic. I don't know there's nothing.
Do you know, I don't know if you guys
have that makes sense.
I had an absolute panic attack when I was like in my mid-teens. I just woke up in the middle of the night and I'd been like just thinking and pondering all night about what happens when you die. And it's like, it just, at that point, clicked with me that nothing happens, and that just, I went into proper full panic attack. So I can see if people are experiencing that, then clinging on to this, you know, this idea of religion and the afterlife is something that is quite appealing to people. But
yeah, if it gets you through, then fair play to you. Yeah,
but yeah, I've kind of, I mean, personally, I've made my acceptance with death. That sounds rather morbid, but
I'm just sitting here watching the clock, waiting for the minutes to pass.
This is not our usual light opening, I have to say. But it's
got less Nazis than usual, but that's about it.
Yeah, it is an interesting question, and one. That...
By the way, I think you can still be spiritual without being religious. Mm. You know, you can still make spiritual connections with other people. In certain settings, like if you were to go to a comedy show, obviously we can't, we're in lockdown, but when you do, you laugh in a different way to how you would just one-on-one, you know, that sort of communal thing. So I think someone religious can probably get spirituality in a different way than we could, but it doesn't mean we can't find it at all.
You know, I'm welcome to be proven wrong. God, if you are out there, feel free to send me a message. I'd love to be one of these people that have
he could become a Patreon, couldn't he? That'd prove it.
Yeah, I could see myself in the Catholic Church, you know.
God has subscribed. That'd be amazing. A few years ago, I did a bet on one of the Super Bowl bets, and it was who the MVP would thank first. And being a predominantly American sport, I plumped for God. And Tom Brady, the dick splash that he was, didn't. He thanked his family first. But it was an amazing thing when I looked back at my Betfair account and it just said, God lost. That's
amazing. Oh, dear. Yeah, you would actually, that would have been a sure bet, surely.
No, I thought so. But I may, luckily, I was still a winner that night because I put a an amount of money that I don't ever want to admit out loud on Missy Elliott coming out and doing a surprise performance at the halftime show. And it wasn't looking good. The clock was ticking, and then all of a sudden, Get Your Freak On hit in the background. And I actually did a lap around my garden because I was very, very worried about how much money I was going to lose on such a stupid bet.
You got your freak on in your garden.
I did.
Well, there you go. Yeah, thank you, Kate, for that. If you want to get involved, then please head over to our Facebook group and submit your questions. We are running a bit low now, so get them in so we can have some for the next show. That out of the way, let's take a look. Let's take a look at some lighter subjects in what we've been playing and watching this week. And I will kick things off by saying I have watched Donald Trump implode on various news channels because, yes, the US elections took place this past week. Still ongoing, they're still counting. Like, you know, how long does it take to count some absentee votes is what I want to know.
Counting's tough.
You watch them on the telly, these count, these, you know, these polling stations, and they're unfolding the paper ever so slowly, and they're having a chat with their mate next to them. You know,
they need to get those dudes over who do it over here, because you've got those sort of cities. I think Sheffield's one of them, isn't it? Who, like, they bang their count out in about 3.5 minutes. You know, like, it's actually a race over
here. Quite right. So yeah. We do things a lot more efficiently in England. Who'd have thought it? But, yeah.
I mean, to be fair, most of them got it done on the day. It's only a few stragglers, and they happen to be close races.
That's a very good point. That's a very good point, Dippy.
We're waiting for a decision still.
We are. Shall I give you a live picture, as it is on Friday evening in the UK?
Please do.
Well, it hasn't changed since about 5 days ago, to be honest. Joe Biden is still sitting on 253. What am I calling these? Points? Space bucks?
Electoral college votes.
Oh, thanks. And Trump is sitting on 214. But there seems to have been some movement in the last couple of hours. I think we were waiting for the results on, what was it, eight or nine states? I can't remember now. Maybe five,
I think.
Okay, maybe less, yeah. And it looks like Joe, good old Joe, has taken over the count in Pennsylvania. So it looks like he's going to, take that vote, and that will actually get
him. That is the big one, because that will, that'll get him
the president. He has, but they'll need a recount. They're recounting Wisconsin again now. So even though they've already done Wisconsin, Trump demanded a recount, so they're doing a recount now.
That's been the highlight of my week, is just seeing Trump implode.
He's done two press conferences where he's come out and said he's won. I understand.
For us in the morning, but I guess for them late at night on election night, I woke up to go to work and I timed it perfectly just for him to come out and do his press conference. And I mean, I don't know. I guess it's probably no different to what we've seen all the way through it, but it was just amazing. Like, he just walked out on stage and just started saying, "We won here, we won there, we won here, we won there." And I'm thinking, I just looked and you didn't, or those ones haven't finished yet. But yeah, he's certainly not going out as a gracious loser, is he?
No, he isn't. But he did say
he wasn't going to, so.
Yeah, but saying I'm not going to and not doing it doesn't make it right, does it? Like, he's still a cock.
DLB, you follow these things a lot closer than I do, certainly. What has been your take on the whole election in itself?
Well, I think the huge turnout is a pretty big story. If you look at, I think it's the biggest turnout in over 120 years or something stupid.
Yeah.
I did read that.
Yeah, exactly. So people say Trump doesn't do anything good. They turned out to vote against him. So,
or for him.
Well, and for him, yeah. You know, the guy has got a phenomenal amount of votes for him.
Yeah, but isn't Biden like the most voted ever?
Yeah, well, at the moment, they're predicting, I think it's 71 million so far, which is, the highest for a candidate ever. So, yeah, I think it kind of does show the divisive nature of Trump, is that he can get a lot of people out for himself. Quite, but, yes, 71 million also don't want him.
It is quite scary that, like, I read it in a non-news outlets and all that kind of stuff, and it's probably true that if it weren't for COVID or whatever, Trump would have probably walked it.
On the night, I watched quite a bit of it as it was happening, and there were times, I'd say like midway through the day, where it was looking like it was going to be even closer and possibly lean towards him. And I must admit, I'm quite surprised that it is as close as it is. I did think that he would see a dip, but the support there is still there for him, isn't it? I mean, you look across the map when they show the areas in red and blue, depending on the party. And I know this is down to population of them, but actually, yeah, if you look at the map, there is a lot of red, isn't there? And it's worrying.
Why do we think that is, though? Well, how can any sane person think, look at the last 4 years and say, four more years
of that, please? They're not sane.
Oh, okay. That's a fair point.
Well, and also, I think, you know, we do live in a world where, and I, you know, this isn't just for this, but for a lot of things, I think we talked about it in the last couple of weeks, where a lot of people are swayed by just the media that they watch. And unfortunately, he has a lot of supporters and a lot of media that people watch. I mean, like Fox News always being, and I know there are comparative ones on the other side of the argument, but you look at like Fox News and they will report as a news channel things as facts that aren't remotely close to fact, but they would be very probably beneficial to Trump. And if that's the only news you ever hear and you believe news, I guess you believe that everything's done right. And there are a lot of people who I think have probably benefited under Trump or feel like they've benefited, you know. I don't think they probably have benefited anywhere near as much as they think they have. And if they have, it's for the wrong reasons. But you know, he brings out a certain sort of people and he knows how to speak to an audience. And I think he unfortunately probably speaks to people's baser instincts, you know, like he will lean on the turning people against each other, people's race, the divisive things, the more negative emotions. There was a lot of talk about people wanting something different going into the last election. Well, they certainly got something different. And for some people, that clearly resonated. And for more people than I thought it would, I thought this would be a bit more of not a landslide, but a bit clearer and an easier path to victory for Biden than it was.
Yeah, I think ultimately it worked against him, though, didn't it? Because most of Biden's vote, why he's beating Trump, is obviously non-white Americans. You see on the news loads of examples of black people and all that, giving examples why they're voting for Trump and all that kind of stuff. To me, it's madness, but obviously everyone's entitled to their opinion.
Mm. Well, not if they're stupid.
Yeah, well, we've got Boris, man, so we can't really say talk.
True. People in glass houses and all that, I suppose.
I like some of the tweets were like, we need to move to the UK where they know how to do it.
Yeah.
I'm like, come on then.
I also, and it's that picture of him, isn't it? Like being hoisted up, and that's a classic picture.
I also liked the tweet on social media where it said, in Britain we have a far more sophisticated electoral system, and then you see Boris, and behind him is a man in a suit of armour, Mr. Blobby, and someone else all lining up as they get their results from the last general election.
Blobby was robbed, man. Yeah. Should have. That's if we're going to recount anywhere, it should be there.
Oh dear, but yeah. So I guess it's kind of run its course over the next few hours. I would say probably over the weekend. Hopefully, we'll start to get an idea of the way things will go. Do we think he'll concede at any point? What's the end game for Trump here? Scarface ending?
There's really not any precedent for it. So I don't know what would happen if he didn't, but I presume he would just eventually leave because no one wants him there.
Yeah, I mean, it's just the madness, isn't it? Like his press conference as well as saying I won when he didn't and spouting all those facts. He's like, he's shitting on his own country's, you know, voting system, and the democracy there is basically just saying, you know, this, you know, is shit unless I'm winning.
I just hope that he doesn't concede at any point and you get some magical moment where they have to send a couple of boys in to actually forcibly remove him. Just holding him up by our arm while his little legs are wiggling. Like, that'd be fantastic.
Every time I try and look at his Twitter account, I can't actually see his tweets because Twitter just keeps hiding them. Yeah. Just to go against the election policy and all that kind of stuff.
Just everything he says.
Well, there's been quite a few bits in the last couple of days, haven't there, where certainly the American news stations, as he's been giving some of these speeches, they've actually cut away and said he's not telling the truth. And I do think they're right to do that. But I do think they should have been a bit braver for the last 4 years and done that more often. And doing it on his way out doesn't really show a lot of bravery for me.
No, and I've not paid too much attention to all the candidates, so I don't really know too much about Biden. But the press conferences he's done while Trump is imploding have been amazing. He's just been cool as fuck. He's just like, yeah, we'll just wait till the votes count.
Yeah, just solid.
I'm pretty sure it's just going to turn out in our favour.
I said it's... I said it a couple of weeks ago, I think Biden's the right candidate for now. Yeah. I didn't think Hillary was a good candidate for 2016, but I think just someone solid who's not going to rock the boat, who's going to go to work and try and fix things. Yeah.
He's already said, like, you know, when I get in, I'm just going to reverse that Paris thing about the environment that Trump did.
Right.
As soon as I get in, you know, that's reversed, no problem.
A calming influence on the world. That's what we need. We really do. Okay. A unifying.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully he tries to get some kind of relationship back together with China because, you know, they are one of the biggest countries in the world for trade and all that kind of stuff. You don't really want to be messing around with it, but...
Having a president that doesn't refer to it as a China virus is probably a good first step, I reckon.
Yeah.
I imagine so, yeah.
Yeah, so I guess this time next week we'll know who the next president... Well, I'm saying that.
Come on.
Actually,
there's a lot of recounts
this
to go yet, mate.
Yeah. Well, hopefully we'll have a better idea anyway.
So there's half a chance we could know by the end of the broadcast this evening, but probably
not.
Yeah,
I've kept it up in the background because there was some talk that they think a couple of those states could declare in the next, well, this is before I come on, so in the next hour or two. But so, yeah, if we get a new president of the United States of America, we'll put that here. But, I mean, ultimately, like for me, it looks like it'll be Biden, and I'm glad it is because... I think the world needs to move away from ridiculous publicity stunts like Trump being president. And I hope that the UK follows suit in, God, how long have we got?
4 years or something.
Yeah.
4 years. Four more years.
If they're presented a reality TV show or some sort of comedy panel show, then they shouldn't be running the country as far as I'm concerned.
I guess the question is, does Trump appear at WrestleMania? That's the question. Do we think?
Could do.
Well,
they could get a Biden lookalike for him to fight, couldn't they? Like they did with him and Rosie O'Donnell that time.
If Trump doesn't win, I don't think Vince will be running the company, man. I think he'll sell it because he's going to get attacked by that dude, man. If Biden gets in, he's going to be forced to give the employees rights and everything. It's game over for him. I reckon he'll sell the company, man.
Yeah, none of this Twitch shenanigans by Vince, you know. Vince for 2024. Should we start the rumour now?
No.
Okay. It'll be Linda.
Oh God. Well, as long as she's in a wheelchair.
That's what I was going to say. Like they'll rock that out for the sympathy vote, won't they?
Just sitting there.
Yeah.
No campaign speech or anything.
Exactly. She'd have to have her mouthpiece.
Until Trish Stratus walks by and then she gets up and kicks Vince in the bollocks.
I'd vote for that. There we go. That was my first take from the week. Let's talk about the boys then. Midge, you've watched season 1 and 2, haven't you? I'm sure you have.
Yeah, I've watched both. I think Seddon's watched both now.
Yeah, yep. I think we're all at that point now where we can kind of have a bit of a blowout because I have watched series 1 and 2 to completion.
But the thing is, are we talking about Butcher or are we talking about Butcher and the Blade from AEW?
Yes, there was some confusion during the week. Not by me, not this time, no. Bless him, Seddon.
To be fair, they do both have the same name. They're both called Butcher. And, you know, it could have been Frank Butcher that I could have been talking about.
Other famous butchers, yeah. Frank. Yep.
That spinning bow tie, you can't forget that.
Sexiest scene on TV ever.
I'll lay my cards on the table. I'm loving it. I'm so sad that it's kind of come to an end now. That was 16 episodes that just kind of flew by for me. great series. You know.
And now you've got to wait a year like the rest of us.
I know. I was so lucky. I didn't have a gap really between series one and two because there's quite a big cliffhanger there. But yet another cliffhanger, really, kind of at the end of series two. Essentially, for DRB and for listeners who haven't seen The Boys, this is an Amazon Prime show. Set in an alternative kind of present day where superheroes are real. You know, they walk among us. They're treated like major celebrities, gods almost, kind of headed by this mega conglomerate called Vought, who kind of almost like franchise these heroes out to other states and countries all around the world. And, you know, they've got like massive movie productions. You know, in some ways it does mirror real life, you know, with the Marvel films and, you know, how popular superhero culture has become. But the twist on it is they're pretty much all flawed characters. You know, they're pretty much all bastards. You know, they're not the American kind of ideal superheroes that Superman is. I mean, the Homelander, which is kind of like The Boys' version of Superman. He's one of the best probably villains in a TV show for quite some time. He's such a, well, he's a cunt, basically, but he's, I don't know, he's very charismatic, you know, he's very watchable, and, you know, he's a well-written character, I think. This is based on a comic, isn't it? I don't know how it compares to the comic, how closely it follows the storylines, but, I'm just fascinated by it in its depiction of, like, it's commentary on our obsession with the superheroes in cinema and in culture, and how we kind of treat these, like, you know, we almost like slaves to these mega corporations, and we treat them like, you know, fanboys, like, treating like these companies as godlike creatures. It's fantastic kind of as a summary of our culture today, I think it's fantastic. It really holds
really
up a mirror
to
where we are in the world, which is quite sad, really. But
it touches on like how we revere famous people as well. And obviously in this, the famous people are the heroes, but how more willing we are to overlook some absolutely horrendous behaviours they're a bit famous.
I think I've said it before, but one of the things I really like about it is the good guys aren't really good guys.
Yeah.
There's some lines they cross, and even you think to yourself, you know, are they really the good guys with what they're doing? They're so intent on an end goal that they'll cross, a butcher especially, will cross any line to get there. And sometimes you think, you know, are they really the good guys? So I'm looking forward to the next season. Like you say, I think it's a year or so away.
I'm assuming there is a series three coming.
Yeah, they already announced that the guy, I don't know if you know him, but the like the more gruff guy from Supernatural, Jensen Ackles, is the actor's name. I think he's a really good actor, doing comedy kind of stuff. If you've ever seen Supernatural, he's going to be like Soldier Boy, a new hero in season three. They've got some stuff lined up, but I don't want to spoil it, but it's not really spoiling it because they already said, but even people that you may have thought aren't going to be back for season three are actually going to be in season three. So
that was one of the things I was going to ask, and you said about it there, Mid, is I was wondering whether there are any sympathetic characters in it, and if they are, like, who are the sympathetic characters? Because I guess you have the good guys, but as you say, a lot of the good guys are share the same flaws. I guess the only difference is that they're not necessarily mega wealthy, mega powerful, and abusing their power that way. But they're certainly not clean, wholesome heroes, are they?
No. Well, maybe Huey's the one angel, isn't he? Out of the rest of them, so.
Yeah, we certainly see the story through his eyes to start with, don't we? And he's thrown into this situation when A-Train, the super speedy soup, basically just runs through his girlfriend at the time, and she explodes in massive blood and guts. And that's like in the opening, 5 minutes of this first series. So he is literally thrust into it, you know. And he kind of, it feels like we're viewing the world through his eyes, and his reactions and to this like fantastical world, and we're like exploring it through, because he's the everyman, isn't he? Basically, I find, you know, he's the most relatable character.
I think you're sort of spot on of going, like, admittedly, as much as it happens in the first 5 minutes, I think you're kind of, your expectation is that he was just like us. He was probably milling along, living his life and not really giving much thought. And slowly but surely after that event, his eyes get more and more opened to what is actually happening with, as you say, the mega corporations and the heroes. I don't know. I mean, I quite... It's tough because I've read the comic book, like the whole thing, and of course, you know, there's some spoilers in there for what might come, but of course they could deviate quite a lot from here. But when you say what the similarities, it is very, very similar. Even right the way down to it starts exactly the same way in the comic book of his girlfriend getting mashed to bits by a speedster. One of the weird small differences is the character for Huey in the comic book is Simon Pegg. So like the artist, and in fact Garth Ennis, the writer, asked the artist, could he draw him like Simon Pegg?
Oh, really?
And in series one, Huey is played, I can't even remember the name of the actor who plays Huey, but his dad is actually played by Simon Pegg, because obviously Simon Pegg would be a bit too old now for it. But yeah, you get like little nods like that. And the sort of overall story, so the absolute power corrupting absolutely, I guess, for the heroes, that rings true for the comic book. The only thing, I think I mentioned it before when we talked about it, is where the comic book deviates quite a lot is it is predominantly about sexual deviancy in that. And there are bits of that in this, but every single storyline, the heroes would be in some sort of sexual deviant situation, and that would be the lead off for most of the stories as they went. And it did lean into the political side and the social commentary. Oh, but yeah. While someone had a hamster up their ass, that was generally like in the comic book how it went. And I would say I've enjoyed the TV show more because I found that the comic book struggled a bit, because you just kind of got bored of that side of it. You just like, oh, come off it. Like, I've seen all this before. Whereas, because the TV show doesn't tie itself so much to that, I found it sort of much more refreshing. It's kept to that core and probably more interesting, wider story.
So Huey is played by Jack Quaid, who is the son of Dennis Quaid and Meg Ryan.
Oh,
wait. Yeah, there you go. I didn't know that, but yeah. Yeah, I think it's great. I think Huey is one of my favourite characters in it. I don't know, something about the deep also kind of does it for me. I know he's a massively flawed sex pest. I know that.
I don't understand your love for the deep, because the man is a fucking scumbag. Like, he's an absolutely gross scumbag.
Yeah, perhaps that's why I like
him. Deep's just like a comedy character, isn't he?
He's like, he does feel like the comedy relief, you know, the light relief. Although he did, in episode one, he did perform a sex act. You know, he forced himself upon Starlight, which is, you know,
and again, one slightly noticeable difference from the comic book, and I guess where it's toned down that side of it is in the comic book, it's every single one of the seven that does that.
Right.
So she has to perform a sex act on every single one of them to join the group.
Yeah, I guess in this day and age,
And weirdly enough, the female, like that's the one that I don't know why I feel an affinity with a mute badass killer, but I that's the one that I always sort of kind of gravitate to when I'm watching it. I hope for good things for her.
What are your favorite series, one or two? I mean, I think I lean towards two, to be honest. It felt like it. The second series expanded on a lot more. You know, the first series was kind of setting things up and the world and the universe and a lot of the characters. But in series two, it really felt like they started to flesh some of those characters out, some of their flaws, you know, different dynamics started to play out between them, particularly like Huey and Butcher and stuff like that. You know, it wasn't all kind of... it wasn't all great, you know, there was a flawed dynamic there.
I preferred two. I thought in series two the action scenes were better, like you say, I thought the bits they went into in Butcher's past and all that kind of stuff to try and give you some background to the way he is and all that kind of stuff obviously made it made it just a much better series. And I think Stormfront as a villain made it a lot better as well.
Yep. Stormfront was very good.
It's a rarity, isn't it? Like that second, it's not often you sort of say that, but I'm with you boys. I thought the second season was better than the first. Mm. I think whatever they did in the first season, they obviously learned a lot from it. And maybe it was that confidence that they found an audience, but I think it's allowed them to just do it bigger and better for season two without rinsing and repeating storylines from season one and take it into some different directions.
Yeah, I think it's a good point you bring up, Mids, about Stormfront. And I liked the relationship between her and Homelander and kind of how they interacted with each other. Some bizarre sex scenes in there, I have to say. Superhero sex is quite a thing to watch. But yeah, I thought she brought an added kind of dimension to Homelander's character, if nothing else, because I guess he could have got a bit stale. But yeah, I thought she did a great thing of, kind of reacting with him. And
she was hilarious.
She was funny.
I mean, that's the one thing it does well, doesn't it? It touches on some really dark stuff, but the humour is fantastic in it.
Oh yeah,
like the dark humour that it hits is great.
It's massively violent as well. I loved it.
I thought I've not read the comics. I don't know if this is going to happen, but I thought the most interesting thing about Stormlander was that compared to Homelander, was that she was just like pure evil. Whereas Homelander, I don't know if this is going to happen. I've not read the books, but I can see a redemption arc for Homelander at some point.
Strangely enough, comic books, there is no Stormfront. Really? That is a kind of totally new. Yeah, that's a totally new storyline for the show. I mean, they touch on again where the comic book slightly differs is it touches a lot more on more superhero teams. And I say there's no Stormfront. There might have been one in one of the teams, but not in the Seven. And it has a lot of analogies to the X-Men in there and things like that. There's the G-Men, which is a load of young men who live in a mansion with an old bald dude who may or may not make them perform sexual acts on him to get into the G-Men and things like that. Nice. So there are a lot more characters, but certainly there's not a Stormfront-esque character who comes into the Seven and plays a role like they show in this. So, yeah, that was really interesting for me as well, how it had deviated a bit.
Yeah, I wonder if
I'm not sure on the Homelander Redemption story bit, though, and nothing to do with the comics, but, and maybe this is, like I was saying to you, Stu, I don't understand the deep, is for me, they're irredeemable. They're irredeemable pretty much instantaneously for me. And that's what I like about it, is that they are irredeemable, and I'm sitting there just waiting for the day when they get their comeuppance. Right. And I know that some nice, good characters might have to do bad things for them to get their comeuppance, but yeah, I can't see to be honest, if there's one thing that would make me turn on that show and switch it off is if they tried to do a redemption arc for him.
I don't really think like a redemption arc. I think like a moment like Vader where he dies being a hero, rather than obviously he just turns good and then the episodes of him being a hero. I think it's just that one moment where he dies saving people.
I just want him to die a miserable, horrible death. I want him to go out like the cunt that he is.
I want that for Black Noir. Black Noir really pisses me off.
I like, I think Mid, you might be onto something, because they do hint a lot of the, some of the relationship between Homelander and his son in that second series. There are moments where he can...
Yeah, there is a lot of sympathy for him sometimes.
Yeah, you feel like he does kind of waver a little bit, and he is kind of questioning his own conscience and, it does certainly
feel like... He's a psychopath.
I know, I'm not saying it's right, but I'm just... That's certainly kind of the tone that the show seems to be going for at that, in certain moments, not all the time, just little moments. But yeah. Fantastic show, I guess, is kind of what we're summarising here.
You said about Black Noir. That's the storyline that I'm really interested to see where they go with that one. And again, like, I won't sort of do any spoilers or anything like that, but he plays a very big part in the comic book, and I'm very interested to see if they go down the same road. They certainly have not hinted that they are yet, but I think that storyline could be very good if they go the way the comic book did. It was one of the more compelling things towards the end of the comic for me. And I just wanted to say very quickly, you said about the the waiting a year for the second season because of the cliffhanger. That was the only thing that I didn't like about season one, is I hated that ending of season one and I hated that cliffhanger. And the only thing I didn't like about season two is I really despised that storyline about the sun.
Did you really?
I think it's really tacked on. I think it's the cheapest bit they've got in the show. And probably because, you know, you're saying about how it at some points maybe makes the Homelander story more sympathetic. And I think because I don't want that, I struggle with that as a storyline, I think.
Yeah, it does. It feels like they're trying to humanise him quite a lot. Using the sun. Okay.
And instead, he's a mass murdering sex pest. And I think that's what we should focus on.
More of that. That's what we need.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. Loving it. Absolutely loving it. Kind of sad that it's over, like I said. But, yeah, roll on Series 3 for me. If we're talking erect penile, it's got
to
be a...
As I say, I think I mentioned it to you guys on Twitter. If you've enjoyed that, give Preacher a go. Made by a lot of the same people and written by the same comic book writer, and different kind of world that it plays in. That's about a lapsed Catholic priest who gets the power of the word of God, so people have to do what he says, and actually he's hunting for God because God has left heaven. And it plays in a sort of similar world. And as I say, the same writer, the source material. And I do think The Boys is a better TV show, but Preacher was a better comic book. But I think you'll really like Preacher as well.
Interesting.
That's on Amazon Prime, I think. But I'll check that while you do your erect penis, if you'll pardon the expression.
For me, I'll go with... I'll go 4. I think that's a fair mark. 4 erect peni out of 5. Quality show. If you have any kind of interest in, you know, superheroes, that kind of culture, then go check it out. It's fantastic.
Preacher is on Prime, and it's 4 seasons and finished, so you get like the full story, but every episode is on Prime at the moment.
Cool, thank you. Next up today, I have been watching the PlayStation 5 reviews. They're all over YouTube. Reviews have gone up for the console, the launch games, peripherals, deep dives into the backwards compatibility modes for the console. Clearly an embargo has been lifted, you know, because everything seemed to drop at about 1 o'clock this afternoon. Watching these videos has got me even more excited for the console, if that is possible. I think generally, obviously the console has some flaws. I think from what I'm hearing, it's mostly around, you know, the user interface hasn't really kind of ironed out a few kinks from the PlayStation 4 days. But I think generally it's been a well-regarded console, and in particular the DualSense controller seems to be revolutionary. But I don't know if you guys have had a chance to check these out, whether it's got your juices flowing again.
Yeah, I checked out some of the videos. Digital Foundry is the first one that I always turn to. They did a video about the backwards compatibility on the PS5. It's looking solid. They said they'd do a separate video on the first-party Sony titles because they're actually getting patched to run better and all that kind of stuff, whereas third-party titles, you can just put them in with no patch and they run. Mm-hmm. 60 frames a second. The only slight disappointment, as I was saying earlier, is that when you put them in, all they play as is basically PS4 Pro mode.
Yeah.
So the resolution and all that kind of stuff stays as it would on the PS4 Pro, but the frame rate goes up if it's an unlocked frame rate. So it'll go up to like stable 60 frames a second or whatever, whereas on the Xbox Series X, they upscale the old games to like 4K and still try and do 60 frames a second. So, yeah, backwards compatibility, even before the embargo, was always going to be better on the Xbox anyway. That's kind of their thing. They've put massive amount of effort even to getting the original Xbox games working, which PlayStation don't really seem bothered about getting PlayStation 1, 2, and 3 working on anything. whereas Xbox, you can play the whole the whole history of Xbox games on even the newest ones. So yeah, it's pretty obvious to put more care and attention into that kind of stuff. But yeah, like you said, the controller.
It looks amazing.
That's my thing I'm most looking forward to.
I can't wait, yeah.
The controller, yeah. The controller, you know, it's hard to put across in videos, but I know when I play it, it's going to be something that probably, if it's got good features on, will make me pick getting the PS5 version over the Xbox version or something like that.
They've really got
listening to people talk about it, who like are people from the gaming industry who could easily be jaded because they obviously interact with so much, but listen, talk to that controller, I'm with you. Like, I never thought I'd be excited about using the controller probably more than I am the games that I'll be playing, but yeah, I'm really fascinated to see how that actually works out. You know, they talk about the different the feelings you get depending on what sort of texture you're running on or where you're doing it, and I hope it's even remotely as interesting as they're making out, because certainly they've sold me on it.
I do hope they're not overselling it, though. You know, yeah. I mean, I've tried HD Rumble on the Switch, which, you know, was impressive in one game, 1-2 Switch. But I'm hoping that this is kind of another level above that HD Rumble. I mean, indications are that it is.
Yeah, it is. And the most important thing is the software engineers have worked on a library where developers can just use it.
Right.
They don't really, on HD Rumble, I don't think Nintendo gave a very good library. On the PlayStation, they've given them, like, you know, just stuff that they can directly call in the game, like, this is sand, this is water. They just put it straight in the game and it just works.
Okay, that's cool.
So it's not too much effort. Yeah. They've already adjusted what sand should feel like, what water should feel like, and all that kind of stuff. And they've given the library just to directly insert it into their games. So.
Interesting. I do hope that, you know, that inspires more third parties to use it, because I think that could be the one sticking point for me, is that it's just, you know, those Sony first parties that do it. Or if it is, or third party. Just...
An inventive usage of it as well. That's what you want, isn't it? You want someone to really kind of take that ball and run with it, to make it enjoyable for you when you're playing the game.
Mm. I watched some of the had a Digital Foundry had a video on Spider-Man as well.
Yes, I watched that as well.
And yeah, it gave a good overview of the game. You know, some people are still going to be disappointed because the ray tracing is a big part of the graphic mode in the game, but it's still not as good as high-end PCs and all that kind of stuff. So people might slightly be disappointed by that, but you're not really going to notice. Like in Digital Foundry, the walk next to a skyscraper, for example, and the reflections look amazing. But on the PC, it go that extra level where the reflections in the reflection have a reflection of a reflection and all that kind of stuff. The consoles haven't got the consoles haven't got the power to do that. So yeah, some people are going to be nitpicking it, all that kind of stuff. But I think it looks incredible.
Yeah. It does. DLB, I want to ask, when do you think you're going to enter the next gen? Or have you no plans?
maybe 2029?
Yeah.
No, it's a bit far, isn't it? No, 2025, I reckon.
Do you, have you watched any of like the PS5? Is it kind of just off your radar because you'd get too tempted?
No, I definitely wouldn't get too tempted. Now, there's nothing at the moment that would even vaguely interest me. And that's more... That says more about me than the consoles, to be fair.
Yeah. I mean, it's fair to say the games aren't really there yet, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's a fair point that you make, DRB.
Even Spider-Man we're talking about, that's coming out on the PS4 as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the only massive game that's not is Demon's Souls. And unfortunately, even though the embargo's ended, that doesn't seem to have any coverage at the minute. So but that's probably got a different embargo or something.
Perhaps it'll be,
I spent far too much of my time today just watching load time comparisons as well, which I never thought I'd do, but I was finding it fascinating because some of them were dramatically different, and even that started to get me quite pumped for it, because I don't think for some of those games I even twigged how long I was waiting for it to load until I watched them load today, and I was like, wow. But yeah, some ridiculous speed on some of them. Certainly the one they keep pushing is the Spider-Man Miles Morales. I think that was going to be one of their showcases for being able to get your game to boot up. And it's like 3 to 5 seconds from switching it on to being in the game. And I was like, yep, some more of that, please. Mm.
That that when you press that button on the main menu to continue your game, it's almost instant. It's crazy stuff.
Although watch one for Destiny 2 and that still seemed to take 4.5 hours to load in. But just not 4.5 hours and another 30 seconds.
I wonder what Avengers will be like.
Avengers, yeah, it's exactly what I was thinking. Still be sat there for 4 days waiting for it to kick in, just to be dropped off the edge of something that I didn't even know I was on.
Yep. I suspect it'll be Dragon Age for DLB. When that comes out, that's when it'll crack, I reckon.
I wouldn't be surprised. It also depends if the FF7 Remake Part 2 is exclusive to that. We'll see.
DRB, I think, on touching on that, I think this weekend they're announcing the Mass Effect remaster.
Oh, yes, I saw that.
Of course.
So yeah, There'll be some coverage of that over the next few days. I think that's going to be on obviously the normal PS4 and Switch and all that kind of stuff. So that'll be one to watch out for you, I think.
Might be worth a lot. I mean, I wouldn't get a next-gen console just for that, because...
I think it's on the old ones. I don't think it's going to be on... It's going to play on the new ones, but I don't think it's targeted for the new ones.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Yeah, so, some interesting coverage. Do we want to touch on Xbox? Because they did have their, like, moment in the light this week as well. Was it like this past week? I can't remember, but... Mid-year, kind of on the countdown now.
I'll get mine next Tuesday, I think, mine comes.
The race was from Pioneer.
So just trying to decide where to put it. I'm just looking around now. I don't know where I'm going to put it.
The cupboard, surely.
Yeah. Yeah, the box is going to go in the cupboard, yeah. But I don't know. I want the Xbox standing up and the PS5 flat, I think, is the way I'm going to go. I've got enough room, I think, to put the PS5 flat. So it's just where to put the Xbox standing up. But yeah, I'll find somewhere. Yeah, they've released their coverage, as to be expected. I think the console's great. Obviously, because they've had PS5s in the meantime, they're a little bit disappointed that the Xbox controller's not too much different.
Yeah.
To be expected, they're a little bit disappointed with the launch lineup on the Xbox. But they do say, obviously, in going forward, the next few years or however long it stays out, it's going to be a very good console. And, you know, Microsoft have built well for the future with all those studios they've acquired and all that kind of stuff. So
I think that's a really good point, Mid. I think that's a console to me that really feels more future-proof than the PlayStation in that, you know, not just the console, but like Game Pass and Microsoft, where they are as a company and their first-party studios. It really feels like their time will come, but the PlayStation is more for now.
Yeah, I don't know about it. Obviously, the reviews came out for the S as well, which I'm really glad I didn't get that because it's got like hardly 300 and something gig storage.
Yeah.
Which if you install Call of Duty, that's pretty much full. and obviously some of the resolutions for the games already, like Yakuza Like a Dragon, if you want to run it at 60 frames a second, it drops the resolution down to 900p.
Okay.
If you drop it down to 900p at launch, man, I don't know what you're going to do in the years to come. I can see that being, you know, the original Xbox. It just got binned off for the S. Mm. I can see that being like that. I can see that not lasting more than 2 years.
Yeah, it does feel like a secondary console, you know, something you get for your kids or for someone who's been out of gaming for, I don't know, a couple of generations maybe, and they just want to pick up the cheapest unit they can. It'd be interesting how that sells. I really would.
I think they're both selling pretty well. I don't think that's selling as well as the X. I think the X is selling.
Yeah.
Selling loads more, yeah. But I get mine Tuesday. Hopefully I get Assassin's Creed on Tuesday. If not, obviously one of the main and good things about the Xbox coverage again was Game Pass. So a lot of the Microsoft titles I'll be able to download on day one with big enhancements and all that kind of stuff. So,
are you excited about it? Does it feel like a next gen launch?
Because the kind of gamer I am, the pad of the PS5 is the thing I'm most excited about. I said, so I'm excited to get a new console, obviously, and mess around with the Xbox and all that kind of stuff. But I'm not as excited as I am to play with the pad on the PS5. That's the thing that I'm most excited about.
Yeah, I think I feel the same. You know, you see the Xbox coverage, and it's pretty much the same dashboard. It's pretty much the same controller. It's an evolution of your experience. It doesn't feel new. Whereas the PlayStation, with its new pad and, you know, a lot of the new features that's got, that just feels more exciting to me.
A couple of the reviews I was looking at for PlayStation and for Xbox today were talking about that as a kind of concept of saying this generation we had the most kind of iterations that actually were big improvements on the original consoles, that it feels like this is, despite having that line of saying this is a new generation, that it's just an iteration on again for a lot of people. But no, I mean, I certainly feel like I'm ready for a new generation, even though I've hardly played anything from this one. But I don't know. I think we spoke about it when they were doing the press conferences. I think Sony did a very good job of selling me on this massive, great thing that's going to sit under my telly. And I am very excited about getting it, even though, as we said, there's not a ton of blockbuster games that are coming with it, but there generally isn't with new console launches. But I'm kind of happy to have that bit of kit in my house, and as I say, like, try out the controller and then await these sort of great studios to make these great games that hopefully I'll get to play along the way.
I've watched a few reviews of Astrobot. That's going to be the first thing I completely play through. I can't wait to experience that. A few of the reviews had spoilers, which I didn't watch because I want to experience that and see what kind of little secrets it's got in the game, you know, because it's homage to everything PlayStation, really, isn't it? That's what it feels like.
Yeah, I've only watched the ice level or whatever.
Same here.
So it'll be interesting what little nuggets that has to unearth and how it uses the controller, you know, how it showcases that controller, because that's what it's there for, isn't it? And that's really exciting to me. So we're getting there. We're getting there, aren't we? We'll soon be here.
Next week, I'll be able to talk about it next week.
Yes. Looking forward to it. Just an honourable mention for me, and that's more Animal Crossing. But this time it was the Halloween event on Saturday, obviously, being Halloween itself. So I just kind of logged on and checked out the visitor, which was Jack, who is an anthropomorphised pumpkin who dishes out sweeties to the villagers. Sounds rather disturbing, really. But it was fun, you know. It went on there for a couple of hours and earned my Halloween themed recipes and furniture and clothing. So yeah, it was that's kind of what Animal Crossing has become for me at least these days. It's kind of just checking in on these big events and you know, absorbing the content there like that. I don't play it every day now, but when I do log on, it's still enjoyable. And that is me.
I miss your turnip updates, the old school daily turnip updates.
I'm out of the turnip game, thank God.
Shame.
Yeah, I know. DLB, I'll come to you before we head for a break.
There's really not loads, mate. I said, it's been mainly covering the presidential stuff. I did pretty much finish Forza Motorsport 7. Yeah. I think I mentioned last time I was on, I did enjoy that. But there's not loads of replay value, so I can't imagine I'll pick that up again too many more times. It really has been a stupid US election. It sort of consumes you if you allow it. Yeah.
Well, it does. I mean, you turn on those news stations, those 24-hour news stations, and it's wall-to-wall coverage. You know, having the sight of Kay Burley presenting live outside the White House as our representative.
Kay Burley's on, I run like a wind. But no, anything Sky News without Kay Burley or any of the American stuff, I'm just changing constantly. I'm like, oh, what's going on now?
I will take a break. I was umming and ahhing, but I will take a break here at this point. And when we return, we'll crack on and see what Midian's been up to, and obviously Seddon will close us up. So join us after this.
The sweat that drips between the buttocks of culture. You're listening to the Renaissance Men Podcast.
Welcome back. Still no updates on the US election. They've been sat on the same scores for days.
But to be fair, you'll be listening tomorrow, so they're not going to notice, really, are they?
True. That is very true, yeah.
Scores will probably be the same.
Tomorrow, we will still not know.
Mid, what we do know is that you watched and played some things this week. What were they?
Not really. Well, you don't know, do you? I've played very little. Now, the Elder Scrolls Online has got me in its grasp. That's literally all I've played, is the Elder Scrolls Online still. As a check-in report, as my character is like, level 36 now. I think the cap's 50, and then you get like champion points after that.
US election. That's what they're going for, champion points.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying it. I don't think I've even finished one region yet or got onto any of the DLC or anything like that. I've been playing it mostly solo, unless I happen by someone doing the same quest and they invite me to join a group or whatever, and then I'll do some quests with them or whatever, and they'll help me out. I'll help them out. So yeah, no, it's just really good fun. Don't really have to think about it too much. Pretty simple.
Why did you go back to this game?
Because I'm in isolation. Okay. They all aren't going anywhere, so I might as well play a game that's more vast than any other game.
Yeah.
Unless I was going to play Warcraft, so I thought, well, I'm not going to get bored of this because there's so much to do. I mean, I've played it for God knows how long, and I'm barely scratched the surface. So, yeah. And plus, I wanted a game that I could, like we were talking about, I didn't fancy playing any games that were before my Xbox came out.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas that is an online RPG, so I didn't think it would change that much between playing it on this Xbox and the new one. Hopefully the loading times will change a bit, but apart from that, I think they are releasing a graphical update for it, but they've not said anything. I have tweeted them, because this isn't obviously anyone else's concern, because I don't think the game's massively popular, but no one's tested if this works on the Xbox Series X yet out of the box. So I tweeted Bethesda, Elder Scrolls Online Twitter account, and just asked them, and they're just ignoring me. So
you'd hope it would be.
I'd hope so, but unless they tell me and or someone tests it, I'm not going to know until I actually get my Xbox. So, which is a pain, because I want to sell my old console. So if that doesn't work, I'm going to have to keep it. And then even though I've got an Xbox Series X sitting there, I'll be playing my old Xbox because it can't play Elder Scrolls Online. So. Yeah, I'll keep playing it. I'm looking forward to getting to level 50 and then finishing up some of the main quests and then doing some of the DLC and all that kind of stuff. So
nice. Your lockdown game was I suppose that was your isolation game. Are you going to carry it on into lockdown?
It's quite addictive. So I don't know if you've ever played an online RPG or anything.
Yeah.
Like World of Warcraft or anything, once it gets its hooks into you, it's quite hard to stop playing it.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I'm definitely going to keep playing it.
Nice.
Hopefully it works on the new console so I can just get rid of the others and just carry on with it.
Mm-hmm.
Until the bitter end. Because these things, I think it came out in like 2014, or I was reading it on Wikipedia. I should know because I've got the collector's edition from when it first came out on the PC, obviously. But,
am I not surprised?
So, yeah, it's been going, obviously, for many a year now. And these things, like World of Warcraft, when did that come out, man? That's still going.
Again, it's still got a massive user base as well, hasn't it?
And these games aren't... I mean, to be fair, they do quite well updating the graphics and all that as they go along, while still obviously keeping the base game in there. So, I mean, it's not a bad-looking game for an online RPG. It's quite a good-looking game, I've thought. Even if I don't ever get to the end of it this year or finish all the quests this year, I'm pretty sure it's going to be going for many years. I think they do quite well off the, because you can play it for free or as a subscription.
I was going to ask if it's free to play.
Yes, it's free to play, but I've got the subscription, because with the subscription you get all the DLC in the subscription, and you get unlimited space for resources, so they don't take up your inventory space, which is quite scarce in this game. So it's like anything, isn't it, when it's free, but they put it on the border as if, you know, you're going to get to a point where, you know, you might need more inventory space or you want to play the DLC or whatever. So it's free, but if you're invested in it, you might as well buy the subscription. I think it's like £8 a month or something. So I'm subscribed to that, so, and I'll continue to be until I'll get bored of it, or I've done all. I'm determined to do every single quest in the game is my goal. So I'm not one of these end game people, where some people like doing, like, there's obviously raids in it and all that kind of stuff. all that group content. I'm not really bothered about any of that. That the luckily in Elder Scrolls Online, it's set up that they're like separate quests from like all the normal quests. So they're not really quite classes of quests. They're just something you can go and do, like play PvP or do these raids and all that kind of stuff. There are things you can do, but they don't class them as quests. So I just go along with the main story quests and all that. And like I said before, quite strange for an online game is like it's fully voice acted. So every single NPC that gives you a quest or anything like that are all voice acted. It's not just text or anything.
Nice.
So it's, yeah, it feels like they put a lot of effort into it, and I'll just keep playing it. So next week I'll give you an update on what level my character is. Obviously,
well,
I hope she's 50 next week. But
if you're not level 50, I'll be very disappointed with you, to be honest.
Well, I've got an Xbox to play, man, as well. When that comes, Assassin's Creed, I've got to start playing that as well.
I
finished off Blood of Zeus, so I spoke about last week.
Yes.
I had an episode, or the last episode was like a typical anime kind of last. It was like two episodes long, the last episode, and it was like just a massive battle sequence, like the whole episode. So, yeah, but it's really good. I recommend it if you're stuck thinking I've got nothing to watch. Watch Blood of Zeus. Each episode, apart from the last one, is only like 25 minutes long, so it's nothing you need to be massively giving your time to. And I think there's only like 8 episodes as well. So,
I planned to watch it last week, but for some reason I just never got round to it. But yeah, I certainly think it will be something I'll get through this week. I love the look of the trailer of it, and hearing someone say it's good as well. Yeah, it really does make me want to jump in and do it. So hopefully this weekend I'll power through it.
Wrestling, I did watch some wrestling since last week. I always watch SmackDown every week, so I watched last week's SmackDown.
How's it going in the world of WWE?
It's SmackDown, for me, it's got the best roster and the best storylines. The Roman Reigns storyline is probably the best storyline in WWE at the moment, and it's also got the Sasha Banks and Bayley storyline on SmackDown as well, which those two are probably the best out of everything. Although on Raw, they've got the Fiend now on Raw, and I do think it's really interesting that the Fiend storyline with Randy Orton, they've not forgotten about the past like WWE tends to do.
Yeah, it's very unlikely.
Pretend things never happened, so they're calling back to all that time when Randy set Bray's house on fire and all that kind of stuff. So it's quite refreshing to see that kind of stuff. I don't know about you, Seddon, if you've watched anything. Or
we were saying that last week, weren't we? They seem to, on the Bray Wyatt storylines, they really do let him play in stuff that they've done in the past, don't they? I mean, if you even go back to that Mania match against Cena. You know, like there was so much that played off on the history between the two, and it does seem to be where, and I don't know if it's because he just has a lot more involvement in his stories than some of the others, but I'm with you. I do like the fact that they play back to stuff that happened 4, 5, 6 years ago even. From a wrestling front, one thing I haven't watched this week yet is AEW, and obviously I know I should have because we are coming into Full Gear this weekend, but I guess it coincided with me falling down the rabbit hole, much like DRB, of watching election coverage. But the plan is to plough through AEW tomorrow during the day to make sure I've got that watch before Full Gear. But I don't know, did you watch it? Was it any good?
No, I watched some of the highlights on YouTube. I didn't catch the whole show this week. I'm not too invested in some of the storylines going into Full Gear. The only one that I'm really interested in, as we spoke about, is Kenny and Hangman. I'm really, you know, even a storyline that's been years in the making, Bucks versus FTR, I'm really not invested in it.
Yes, it's strange, isn't it? Because I think the card, like if you look at the matches, they look good, but I feel like how we've got there, and I've got some fears for how they're going to play out on the night. So I'd much rather have just seen FTR, Young Bucks have a match rather than some of the added bits around injuries that they're really, really pushing. And I feel like they may make the match far too much about that story, whereas you just let them boys go and just say, right, have your match. But yeah, without seeing this week, so I don't know kind of whether they added anything more into that. But I hope that the Moxley-Kingston match is good. That's the one that I mean, other than obviously Kenny and Paige, which I think we do know will be good, but that's the other one I'm kind of hanging my hat on of saying we might get like a really decent brawl and not a sprawling Randy Orton 35 minutes but nothing happens kind of brawl. I hope we get a great match out of that, and I hope Kingston gets not the title but the chance to be the star that I think he's earned with his promos over the last couple of months.
Yeah, I think that from this week's episode, not watched it, but Pac had a promo.
Yeah, I did hear
first
he's
time
back
in months, and I think they're leading to him costing Kingston the match. When he comes back, he's going to be feuding with Kingston, because he did allude to obviously with him and the Lucha Brothers were going to be a faction, and that Kingston took him away from him and all that kind of stuff. So I think he'll be feuding with Kingston when he comes back. But yeah, I mean, I think what one went wrong with the Young Bucks is they were doing that kind of heel turn storyline thing to try and tie in with Kenny, but it didn't really work. They've just gone back to complete faces again now. And the stipulation they announced on Dynamite as well is they won't ever challenge for the tag team titles ever if they lose this, which is the same as Cody with the world title. I don't know why they're repeating storylines in such a short space of time.
They seem to be so trying to go against that concept of, because we're executive vice presidents, we're going to abuse our power, to the point where you go, you've gone too far the other way, and I actually do want to see you have title matches. And I understand you've probably got a bit more power in this company, but I don't think you're abusing it by putting you in title matches. You actually deserve to be there.
Yeah.
But I think that's Cody's obsession with trying to differentiate himself from the criticism Triple H got over the years, isn't it?
Yeah, okay. He got his name back, didn't he? He got his last name back because WWE dropped the trademark, and I think some of the press asked him, are you going to be able to challenge for the world title now? Because when you lost the match, you were just Cody. Now you're Cody Rhodes. And he was still like, no, I don't want to, you know, I don't want to ever win the world title in AEW. That'll be overstepping my role or something like that. But his match at Full Gear is, they do have good matches, to be fair. His match at Full Gear is against Darby Allin. And the last match they had was pretty good. But I think the disappointing thing for me with Full Gear is that obviously Kingston and Moxley and Darby Allin and Cody will be good, but the winners are too obvious. It's obvious Moxley isn't going to lose is the world title. He's going to lose that to Kenny, like we've been saying for months. And even though, and it's strange as well, because I say that, but I'm really looking forward to Hangman versus Kenny, and I know Kenny's going to win, but that's different for some reason. I mean, that in my opinion has had the best build of any wrestling feud all year. Which is probably why I feel a bit different about that. And I know, like, the two guys are ridiculously good wrestlers, so the match is also going to be amazing. But in some way, I still think it could go either way, that Hangman might still win, but I just don't think he's going to.
See, the NWA Women's title is in the buy-in, isn't it?
Pre-show, yeah.
I saw that on Twitter. Serena Deeb, never heard of her. Is she any good?
Yeah, she was the shaved head one in CM Punk's Straight Edge Society.
Yeah. I remember you saying that. Versus Alison Kay. So I don't know.
Both very good.
Yeah, I like Alison Kay.
Yeah, both good. And like the AEW women's title, it's like we don't know what match to have. Let's just put Nyla Rose versus Sheeta again.
Yeah, it's a shame, because I'd much rather have the match from the buy-in on the main show and stick that on the pre-show. And I do quite like Sheeta, but yeah, Nyla Rose. Sheeta. Your mum's in the title match on Saturday.
It'll be quite a surprise.
it's how we pay back our Patreon dollars. We say, we've got you a match on telly against a big lump of a woman. Good luck.
Yeah, I like Sheeta, but as Asuka's shown, unless you've got some form of personality, you can't really get across that well when you can't speak English very well.
And I think they need to work on, well, I said they need to, I guess it depends on desire, but they need to work on that women's division, because they just don't have a lot of credible contenders that they can throw in matches.
I think they just need to get, just, you know, come through all this and just put the title on Britt Baker. There's not really much you can do to elevate it than put it on Britt, who can do promos and can wrestle good matches. I mean, you've got to try and elevate that title some way, and she's like far and above the best woman there at the minute. So,
and again, it's hard to kind of get invested in someone. So pick Nyla Rose going against Hikaru Shida, and you just go, well, actually, I want Shida to win. Whereas in a Britt Baker match, you want nothing more than to see Britt Baker lose because she's such a good shitbag heel. But also, you don't ever want to see her lose because you want her to keep that title because you want the promos. And yeah, I mean, I think she's the champion elect, isn't she? They just need to. I mean, she's back fit now, isn't she? And she's doing matches again. So I'm hoping that will be the next program that they build to. But yeah, yeah. I'm looking forward to Full Gear, predominantly because the card is strong, but it is with a bit of fear that they could way overbook this. And I'd rather, I think, just see the matches play out.
Yeah, there's also the pre-film movie star match, isn't there? Hardy Compound.
Yeah.
They're always good for a laugh. I think Matt Hardy's got that down to a T. Obviously, he knows what he's doing with those style of matches, and if it's pre-recorded, you'd hope we don't see him get concussed.
That's what I was gonna say, yeah. Unlikely to get the concussion and the confused match carry-on this time.
Apparently, they've employed another doctor now, apparently, to... There's multiple doctors now that have to make decision if they can carry on with the match or if to stop the match. Because I think someone, one of the Dark Order, so it wasn't Silver, was it? It was the other guy's partner.
Alex Reynolds.
Reynolds got knocked out a few weeks ago and they just literally left him. Yeah. Left him lying in the ring and then just wrestled around him.
And it was, he was spark out. It was
wrestle around his corpse.
Yeah.
Update on
SmackDown. I do agree on SmackDown. I think SmackDown's been really strong. I go into any strong booking in WWE with extreme fear because there's only 2 seconds around the corner. There'll be Otis probably doing something to ruin my evening. I think they have. And certainly since they did the Reigns turn, and you're right with the Banks and Bayley story, they really are hitting out of the park on SmackDown.
Yeah, the only disappointment about SmackDown is obviously you can tell they're building between Daniel Bryan and Reigns.
Yeah.
Having a feud, which, you know, Daniel Bryan can get a good match out of a chairman at a table. And he always, the matches that he has had with Roman Reigns have always been Roman Reigns' best matches, in my opinion. So that'd be good for Reigns, but I don't think I could see Bryan going over Reigns. Plus, they've got the like, obviously, both of the Usos at some point will join Roman. So I can't see any WWE like doing those three-man team versus three-man team things. I can't see any three-man team on SmackDown unless they just put a bunch of people together that aren't normally a team.
I wonder whether they might even go outside of current WWE to fill out this Samoan faction a bit more, because you've got a few family members who are currently wrestling in some of the indies, haven't you? Like... that Jacob Fatu is in MLW, and I've seen a few of his matches, and he's an absolute beast. And I think he would. I'm surprised WWE haven't signed him. But there's I can't remember. Is it Lance Anoa'i who is there? I think he's Roman's cousin. And I do wonder whether they might just make this into a super Samoan stable, so that Vince can get some of his Samoan stuff going, and ultimately turn him into the head shrinkers.
That will probably be the. No, I like the super Samoan stable. It's got a good ring to it. That's probably what Vince will go with.
I think they're cool, and then that might be a good time to call up Undisputed Era after.
Yeah.
After they've got this stable to feud with them.
Samoan stable match with The Rock too.
Yeah, I presume that's coming. The Rock. I presume that's what they're going to build to if they can get in for Mania. But ultimately, I think that's their culmination point on it.
And I just want to see him run some people over. Happy days.
I just want to see him give Heyman some raw meat to have to eat, like a good old Captain Lou Albano days or something like that. Savages.
Samoan stable SS. Yeah. Fantastic. Name it. We have to get a Nazi reference in there somewhere.
Yeah, it has to happen.
It's our MO. Update on the NWA merchandise. You can get an NWA global gold globe face mask to go along with your trading cards that we mentioned several weeks ago now.
How are they publishing those? Because isn't my eldest literally the only person that works for the NWA now? Everyone's left.
It's that way.
James Storm was in TNA the other week.
Yeah.
Obviously, Alison Kay has left. Thunder Rosa's left.
They're in a weird spot, you know. It's you can't help but think it's just dying a very slow death, but no one would admit it. It's like Billy Corgan's just not can't admit it to himself, but I don't know. It's.
I think they're going to end up amalgamating themselves with AEW, aren't they?
I could see that.
It looks that way, doesn't it?
I could see that. I don't know. It'd be a shame, because I really like Power. I liked, you know, the aesthetic they were going with. I thought that's just really interesting hour of wrestling. I really enjoyed
it. And they had some good wrestlers on there as well, didn't they? I thought their roster was decent.
Mm, it went too bad. Went too bad. But we'll see. NWA is a strange beast at the moment. It's kind of always been a strange beast for the last couple of decades, isn't it? I suppose.
All went downhill when they put a title on Big Trevor Murdoch.
Big Trev. Yeah.
Big Trev.
God bless him. Where the hell were we? Mid, is that everything from you?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Seddon, take us home, mate.
Yeah, I haven't got a lot. As I say, a lot of watching at the election, a bit of PlayStation 5 stuff today. Gaming-wise, I played quite a lot of Hearthstone Battlegrounds again. It was a weird week for it because they did quite a chunky patch last weekend to try and address some balancing issues. So did release a new class into it, Elementals, and it pretty much was the strategy to win. It was a race to see who could build their Elemental deck the quickest. Sometimes it was quite fun, but really... it wasn't compelling to play over and over again because it was just a race. So they did a large patch to redress that. And they've actually done a second patch this week as well to change what a lot of the cards and a lot of what the heroes do. But I don't know why this week more than any other week I found it so obsessive. But it was just that concept of as soon as I switched it on, I would go, I'll just have one game. And then I would finish that game and play another and play another and play another and play another, and it really kind of got its claws into me. The other thing I played a bit of this week was Among Us. I played a bit with Midge, and it was quite, I mean, I like the game. I do think it really plays better when you are playing with people you know. One of the problems you have it being an online game is as soon as someone is killed in it or is found to be an imposter, they just bin out the game and disappear, and that somewhat kills it. But a couple of times I've played for a good few hours, and you tend to find in the lobby that you're in is ultimately after about half an hour, you just get people in that lobby who want to stay and play. So it takes a while to get a good lobby together. Mm. Great fun. Great fun being an imposter, great fun not being an imposter. I found it even more fun when playing with Midge because it was lovely to be able to murder him. And also, it was lovely to be murdered back by him. But literally every time he was the imposter, I just had that feeling. And I would see him run near me and I'd be going, fuck off, you're going to kill me, aren't you? And then, 2 seconds later, I was dead. It does scratch a really good itch with that social deduction side of it. Because often when I play online, I play with people I know. Because this is reliant on a lot of players, I play with a lot of strangers. And it did reintroduce me to some of the dark side of online gaming that... you hear about but don't see. And me and Midge and his friend Matt were playing in the lobby, and someone joined who had a girl's name, so obviously every person in there starts talking to her straight away. And I wonder what would have happened if we hadn't have been on. But so someone says to this girl, if she was a girl, how old are you? And she says 15. And I kid you not, within seconds, 7 people had said, can you send me pictures of yourself?
Of course.
And he's just going, well, okay, we might have been in a lobby full of 15-year-old boys, but I don't think we were. So it did reintroduce me to some of the darker side of the internet. Although one of the people who was in there, hats off to him, whoever he was, but instantaneously changed his character name to Peterphile, which, you know, again, there's a good side of the playing online games as well. So, that was a cracking fun. I didn't really do much in gaming other than that. I did think about playing Horizon one day, which I touched on it briefly. I am actually enjoying it, but I just haven't been in the frame of mind to play something that probably is a meatier game. I have wanted things which is a bit more pick up and put down. The only thing I was going to talk about from a watching perspective, and this is a bit of a strange one to talk about from a watching perspective, it is the movie Parasite, which is currently available on Amazon Prime, and it was the winner of the Best Picture at the Oscars this year. And the only reason why I say it's a bit of a strange one to talk about is I don't really want to talk about it much plot-wise, because even the director himself, and I guess this could be considered a bit wankery, but it's like Bong Joon-ho, and when it was released, he said to like reviewers that he doesn't really want reviewers to ever really talk about plot. He only really wants people to talk about what's in the trailer, because he wants people to kind of go in and see it cold and to take their own impression. And I love this movie. Hands down for me, it is one of the best movies I can think of watching in living memory. Certainly,
high praise, high erect praise.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think it has a good shout to be the best movie released in certainly at least a decade and possibly more. And I watched it at the cinema, and I had a glorious week at the cinema where I saw Jojo Rabbit, Parasite and The Lighthouse, and I loved all three of those movies. And I would say for at that period of time, I'd have found it really hard to pick which one was my favorite, because they are very, very different. But I think at the time I'd have lent towards Jojo Rabbit, because I think I was just in the mood for something that, speaking of Nazis, was a bit more lighthearted, a bit more Nazi fun. But watching Parasite back again reminded me of how amazing it is. And it is, I mean, going from what you kind of see in the trailer, it's the story of two different families in South Korea, and the two families are dramatically different on the social status. So you have one family that are all out of work, live in a disgusting kind of basement of a building where drunks come outside and piss like up against their window in the street. And on the flip side, you've got a very, very affluent family that live in a fantastic house. And the house that they live in is a big part of, I'd say, the movie, the look of it. The house almost becomes a bit of a character in the movie. And so this poor family are chancers, I'd say, or con artists to a certain degree. And it's about them insinuating themselves into the life of this rich family and where the story goes from there. As I said, I don't really want to touch on plot at all, but it looks amazing. It's filmed so beautifully. And when I say beautifully, from the poverty-stricken areas that you see of Korea to the mega rich areas and everything in between, and they do a lot around sort of weather patterns. You know, there's certain conditions in the story that kind of move plot lines forward, and the way he films it is breathtaking. And characters-wise, they're just great, and there's such a varied and oddity group of characters in there, but they're just all massively compelling. The odd ones are deliciously odd. The ones who are wankers, you just go, I kind of want to watch you more on the screen, because I want to see you be the twat that you are. Touching on something we said about The Boys, it'd be interesting for when people watch it to do they feel affinity with any particular character, because I would hope that probably most of us don't fit into either of the criteria that the characters are, but you'll see bits of yourself in some of them. But the strongest recommendation I think I'll ever give on this show, it is a Korean movie, so it is subtitled, but even if subtitles aren't your thing, I think this is one not to be missed. And it's hard, because people have very different tastes in the sort of media that they want to consume. And some people want something that is quite easy to wash over them. I wouldn't say go into watching this thinking, I just want something that I can keep half an eye on. I think you do need to give it some time to watch. But even at face value, I think anyone would find in what is quite a dark subject matter, it's very funny as well. The characters have very funny moments. And so I think there's a selling point for a lot of people. And it's one of those movies that I think when you walk away from it a week later, you'll be thinking about it. You know, there'll be bits of it where you kind of mull it over. And as I say, this is my second watch of it, and I think I'm going to have a third watch this weekend again, because I think I could watch this over and over and over and over again. The performances in it, by the way, by the cast, excellent. I mean, some of them I'd seen in other Korean movies that I had seen before, and I don't know. I wouldn't like to say that they stood out more than they ever have done before, but yeah, some real kind of star turns in the movie. And if you do end up watching it and liking it, I'd recommend pretty much anything that Bong Joon-ho has ever done, and in particular for me, Snowpiercer or Okja. And I think Okja is available on Netflix, and Snowpiercer is generally available on one of the streaming services. Mm. But what's the maximum penises I can give to this?
Well, it's a standard scale, 0 to 5.
Yeah, 6 penises then. I'll do the cheaty Dave Meltzer 6-star classic, the 6 penis classic. And I mean, I looked forward for this weekend because I do want to get some stuff watched. I must admit, coming into today, I felt a little bit media starved. And I did see that on Sky Movies, they've added Doctor Sleep. And yeah, and also they added Invisible Man last week, which I hadn't got around to watching. So I am going to try and get Invisible Man and Doctor Sleep watched. And Netflix have added Into the Spider-Verse, which I've seen before, but I will be watching that again this weekend. So I'll have a sort of talk through all of them next week. And possibly The Lighthouse as well, because now that I'm watching
Sky too.
I've seen that's been added on there, and because of my love for him at the beginning of this year, I think I'm long overdue a revisit to that as well. But yeah, that was it for me, I'm afraid.
That's right. Where can we catch Parasite? Did I miss that?
Amazon Prime.
Oh, it's on there. Prime. Oh, okay.
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah, I think it got added like Monday or Tuesday this week.
Yeah, it's interesting what you say about the director not wanting to give too much away about plot in interviews and stuff, because when I came away, you know, when it got the Best Picture Oscar, I'd never heard of it, so I went to look at the trailers, and I came out still not really understanding what the film was about. So
I mean, strangely enough, like I watched the trailer again because of that, and I thought because it was an instant for me anyway, because I like his movies, but I did watch the trailer again, and it doesn't tell you a lot. And one of my fears for when a director says please don't tell people, or like what happens in it, I think it almost intimates to people like it's going to be almost a From Dusk Till Dawn kind of twist or something like that, and I certainly don't want to suggest it's that sort of thing, but I can see why he didn't want it talked about, because I think it is kind of nice to experience the story in one go. And from watching the trailer, most of the things you see in the trailer.
Hello? Is he gone?
That's what the film's about.
So. he's been
he disappeared. Taken by the
parasite.
Are you there, Seddon?
Hello? Can you hear me?
He disappeared.
Did I? Sorry.
Yeah, it's like it was an amazing piece of timing. You said, oh, I don't know. He's talking about the plot, and then you just disappeared. Like,
there you go. But yeah, the trailer doesn't give much away. But I'd say for anyone who's listening, watch the trailer. And if you're in the slightest bit intrigued about what it's going to be or where it's going to go, give the movie a watch. Or ultimately, just watch the movie. It's fantastic. I mean, I looked comparatively to a lot of the other Best Picture ones, because I kind of like to do comparisons when I see stuff. And I think certainly in the last 10 years, there's been some decent Best Pictures. But comparably, like, it stands head and shoulders above anything else that's got the Best Picture in that time.
Interesting. High praise. 6 peni.
6
peni. Unheard of. What we are coining the freak show, I guess. Is,
Don't call me a freak.
6 peni. Wow. Okay, thanks, Seddon. Thanks all, really, for all your input this week. I do have a couple of And Finally stories for you before we wrap up. The first, let me get this up, is a subject close to my heart, really. Let me just open this link. This comes from the Times of India. A 27-year-old chartered accountant has filed a case of breach of trust against her husband for hiding the fact that he is bald. This chap had gone through the whole relationship with a toupee on, and she had no idea he was bald and was shocked to learn that her husband had been wearing a wig. And this had not been revealed to her before the arranged marriage had taken place. In a complaint to the police, she stated that had she known about the then prospective groom's bald status, she would have rejected the proposal. The woman confronted her in-laws, who told her that it was a minor issue. What a bitch, is all I can say.
That's to say, like, harsh on bald people.
I know. He could be the most... You would be.
I don't know, is it viewed as a sign of impotence or something in India? These different countries view it as different things, don't they?
I think you'll see. I think you'll find it's sexual prowess, actually.
Okay.
Which is why you and DRB both have luxurious locks.
You're thinking that's why she rejected it. She thought he'll be too powerful in bed.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So you know, I think this is a tragic tale. And, you know, something that us fellow baldies have to, contend with every day of our lives. So, yeah, I'm with you, Mr. Mumbai Baldy Baldy. Yes, you have
did
my
you, did you also wear a toupee before you got married? Is that what you mean by I'm with you?
That would have been a great moment at my wedding, having exchanged vows. Just whip the rug from my hair.
That'd be weird as shit for me at your wedding. if I turned up and you had hair, I'd be like, what the fuck is going on here?
Whip it from my head like I was whipping a tablecloth from a table. Just whip it off. That would have been strange, but no, I've sadly struggled with hair growth for many a year now myself. To the point where Benji... Actually, that's a very good point. It brings up a good story. Amanda and Benjamin were... in our local town, obviously prior to lockdown, I think this was a couple of weekends ago. Amanda was going to get her eyes checked at the local Specsavers, and Benjamin caught a glimpse of the window display, which all it featured was the an egg-shaped head, no hair, glasses. It looked like an egg with glasses, to be perfectly honest with you. And he immediately thought it was me in the photo. He came home saying it was me in the photograph.
Reminds me, I read yesterday that the Oliver twins have coded a new Dizzy game during the first lockdown.
Nice.
It's coming out on the Switch. That just completely reminded me of that.
Oh, good. But that is actually really good news. Yeah. Nice. I love a Dizzy game. I love those on the C64. And he calls me, he says I've got a headache, so, you know, it's just a bit I've learned to live with, quite honestly.
Feeding him. He'll soon stop it if you stop feeding him.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's not what turns around to child abuse, though, is it not?
Yeah, but, you know, who will know? The only people will know is us and the listeners. It's fine.
You would have got this far, but you would have heard at the start of the show, hopefully DRB can edit it in, but... Benjamin did make a cameo, which I've recorded, so feel free to chuck it in whenever you can, DLB. It's in the drive, ready to go.
All right.
Yes, he does make his first appearance on the podcast.
Is he calling you Baldy or something?
He's not, no. He's calling me something else.
Nice.
Yeah. Cunt. No, he's not. He's not. Okay, my second news story. Let me get this up. I should be more prepared already. But this is kind of interesting too. On April 28th, there was a powerful burst of radio waves. It was only a thousandth of a second long. Washed over the Earth. lighting up radio telescopes in North America. And this is from the National Geographic website, by the way. It's basically, it was a radio station that had emanated from
Snowman by Times, is it?
It's not, no, not as reputable. But yeah, this radio signal has emanated from the depths of the Milky Way. So this opens up a whole host of possibilities. What the hell is it? I'd like to think it's another kind of foursome in the universe. Yeah. Miserable, pot-bellied aliens just going on about, I don't know, their space alien Nazis. Equivalent. Yeah, space Nazis, their equivalent of Donald Trump. You know, Renaissance men, alien style. That's what I think, anyway, but probably isn't. It's probably just, I don't know what it could be. It's interesting, though.
Why don't things like this make it into the news? Why does it see so much shit on the telly? And something that's like actually relatively interesting, albeit like not something that we know anything about or can put anything substance to, but at least that's like compelling and interesting, isn't it? Rather than repeating the same story on the 24-hour news circle over and over again.
Well, that's what we're here for, you know?
Yeah.
We could have made a connection, really. So I think our ambition should be to put this show out into space. We should be the representatives of Earth in the podcasting world.
Put us out into space. Just send us up there now. Go into isolation on a space station.
Apparently it was, let me read this. It was an extremely intense flash of radio waves. They think it could be an exploding star to alien. Oh, that's quite a wide-ranging opinion, really. It's either an exploding star or alien technology. So they're really kind of hedging their bets there. It's either something sciencey or, fuck it, we're getting invaded. But, yeah, there we go.
We were talking today about we were saying about how, and I think we talked about on here, how sometimes this year it's felt like you're in like a TV show or a movie because of all the strange stuff that's been going on. Mm-hmm. And someone I work with said, oh, you know, like America could go on the brink of civil war, and I was saying, well, at least that's like the plot's changing slightly. Maybe this is the third season. They're setting up the spoilers now for when the aliens invade for season three.
Nice, yeah, could be. Yeah, it's interesting times, really. Really is. I was going to say something else. What was I going to say? Can't remember that.
Were you going to say if I was that Indian fellow who got caught being bald, I'd have blamed it on this radio waves and said, no, it wasn't a wig. I had full head of hair until that happened. The alien stole my hair.
Indeed. There we go. That was the Renaissance Men episode 73 for you. Hope you enjoyed it. It's been a pleasure to record. My thanks to Mid, DRB and Seddon for joining me this week. All that's really left for me to say is until next week, please take care, stay safe of course, and goodbye. Thank you.